Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. The original plan for this week's programme was to continue our focus on climate mitigation technologies with a look at some of the astonishing developments taking place with graphene around the world. But it'd be a bit remiss of a climate and sustainable energy channel if we completely ignored the record temperatures at both ends of the scale that have been afflicting places like Australia in the Southern Hemisphere and the US and Canada in the Northern Hemisphere this month. So we'll be looking at graphene in a later program, and instead this week we're going to take a look specifically at the cold snap that's walloped the Midwest in recent days. We'll also give a whole video to looking at the changes in the Australian climate a bit later in the year, so it'd be great to get some first-hand experience and anecdotes from those of you watching from that part of the world. Coming back to the States though, I know everyone's throwing the phrase polar vortex around as if it's some kind of once-in-a-lifetime freak phenomenon, which it isn't. Now, I'm quite sure that you well-informed folks out there will already be well up to speed with this and what caused such dramatic drops in temperatures across the Midwest this week, but nevertheless, I thought it was worth taking a look at information from some of the experts in the field to get their perspective on why this particular cold snap has been so extreme and why they appear to be happening more often. Because apparently, it's a perfect example of how global warming is having an effect on climate change. And that's a concept that can sometimes be a bit confusing for some people. So what's it all about? How can global warming cause minus 40 degrees in Chicago? To be fair to Mr. Trump, it is on the face of it completely counterintuitive. Here in the UK, we have a great science communicator called Simon Clarke. Simon has a PhD in atmospheric physics from the University of Exeter, and he's been talking to us about climate matters on his YouTube channel for several years. Last winter, when we experienced very similar circumstances to the ones we're seeing this week, Simon released a very informative video explaining the complicated meteorological interactions that drive these events. And you can watch that presentation by clicking here. An equally inspirational and educational commentator over there in the States is Ethan Siegel. Ethan is a theoretical astrophysicist and science writer who runs a blog called Starts With a Bang. In his article for Forbes.com this week, Ethan tells us that these extreme cold snaps have gotten more severe in recent years due to a combination of global warming and a phenomenon you've likely heard of, the polar vortex. We all know that our planet is warmer in the mid-latitudes near the equator than it is at the poles. The warm air from the equator tends to move towards the cold air in the Arctic, but because the Earth also spins, these air currents get dragged around with it, giving us prevailing winds like the jet stream. The temperature difference also causes a low pressure zone that rotates at each pole, and it's this that the scientists call a polar vortex. The jet stream circulates at a height of about 6 to 7 miles above the surface of the Earth, which is about 30,000 feet, which is the height that commercial airliners fly at, hence why the flight from the US to Europe is usually quite a bit quicker than the flight going the other way. The polar vortex is much higher, at about 30 miles above the Earth's surface. The bigger the difference in temperature between the equatorial air and the Arctic air, the faster and straighter the jet stream moves around the planet, and the more circular and well-defined the polar vortex is. As Ethan Siegel tells us, when the vortices are at their strongest, you get a single cell and the air is extremely well confined. But the Arctic is warming much faster than the rest of the planet. And this is something I discussed with Professor Peter Wadhams during our conversation back in November last year.
So even in the IPCC report, they've said that the Arctic has warmed by 1.9 degrees Celsius just in the last 30 years. And that's reducing the differential between the mid-latitude warmer regions and the Arctic cold region, which, as I understand it, is having an effect on the jet stream.
It is an effect where it implicates sea ice and Arctic warming very strongly. And the person who originated the theory is Jennifer Francis from Rutgers University. And most people agree with her analysis now that what's happening is the Arctic's warming about four times as fast as the rest of the planet. So the difference in temperature between the Arctic air mass and tropical air masses is getting less. Because the temperature difference has gone down, the driving force for the jet stream is less. So the jet stream slowed down, And as it slows down, instead of being a straight line, it goes into lobes, north-south lobes. Okay. It's like a river flowing over a flat estuary. It tends to meander. So you've got a meandering jet stream, and with a meandering, it means that Arctic air is carried down to much lower latitudes than it should get to. And then in between, there's regions where tropical air is carried to much higher latitudes. So
the second effect of this warming is that the polar vortex also weakens and starts to lose its neat circular shape. Ethan continues, the phenomenon that causes the polar vortex to break down is known as sudden stratospheric warming, where the upper layers of the atmosphere increase in temperature by about 30 to 50 degrees Celsius, which is 54 to 90 degrees Fahrenheit, over the span of only a few days. A warmer Earth, he says, makes sudden stratospheric warming events more likely and more frequent, and those events destabilize the polar vortex, bring cold air down into the mid-latitudes, and cause the extreme weather we're experiencing right now in the States. You can actually watch these developing weather systems for yourself at Google's Earth Null School. This is an animation from last winter showing how we'd normally expect to see the polar vortex. Even though this one's a little bit further south than we'd normally expect it to be, you can see that it's a continent-sized donut of winds rotating in a neat circle at speeds of up to about 200 miles an hour. And this is a compilation animation showing this winter's actual polar vortex on the left and the consequent jet stream on the right during January 2019. By the 3rd of January, the polar vortex had split into three vortices, with the two main circulations happening over Scandinavia and North America. By the time we get to the 9th and 10th, the vortex has strengthened towards the top end of Canada before collapsing again to reform a secondary rotation further south towards the Great Lakes. At the same time, if you take a look at the jet stream on the right-hand side, you can see a really dramatic trough pulling all that sub-zero Arctic air right down through Canada and into the United States. If we stop the clock at the 25th of January and take a closer look, you can really clearly see how those temperatures of minus 40 are being carried directly down from the North Pole straight into the northern states. And you can also see just how chaotic the jet stream is all around the globe. Approaching today's date, which is Sunday the 3rd of February, the polar vortex looks to be heading back north, and the jet stream trough is finally moving on. As the Earth begins to warm, scientists tell us that extreme weather events like this will become more commonplace, with many climatologists predicting an unstable polar vortex bringing us storms like this multiple times a decade. Here's Professor Peter Wadhams again.
And the problem with all that is these extreme events will keep happening now, because that's the way the jet streams become. We're not going to escape from either extreme heat or extreme cold events during the winter. So it's not weather, extreme weather we're getting, it's extreme climate, that the climate has changed.
Welcome to the new normal, says Ethan Siegel, courtesy of global warming, where the Arctic can't even remain cold in the dead of winter. That's it for this week. I hope you enjoyed this little interlude in our planned schedule. If you found it useful and informative, then please do share the video and hit the like button. You can also subscribe, and if you hit the bell icon when you do that, you'll be notified of when all the new programs come out. And you can do that by clicking here. As always, thank you very much for watching. Stay warm if you're in the north, and stay cool if you're in the south. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.